City Council representing Alston and Brighton. Today is Monday, April 25th, and we are here to review the FY17 Administration and Finance Overview of the Fiscal 17 City Budget. Joined by several of my colleagues today, I'd like to introduce them in order of their arrival. To my left, Councilor Josh Zakem, Councilor Tim McCarthy, Councilor Matt O'Malley, Councilor LaMartina to my direct left here, Councilor Jackson to my far left, Councilor Baker over to my right, as well as Council President Michelle Wu and Councilor Andrea Campbell. Thank you all for coming today. I'd like to remind folks that this is a public hearing. It is being broadcast on Comcast Channel 8 as well as RCN Channel 82 and recorded for viewing at a later time. I'd ask folks in the chamber to silence all their electronic devices. We will have a presentation from the administration on the budget, at which time we will take take questions from my colleagues. At the conclusion of that portion of the hearing, we will take public testimony, and I would appreciate if anyone wishes to testify publicly to sign up at the sheets at the front and to my left by the door. We would ask that you state your name and affiliation and limit your comments to a few minutes to make sure that everyone is heard at today's hearing. We have also added a new opportunity for people who can't attend hearings via Google Hangouts. So we'll take up to 10 people for online testimony via Google Hangouts at each hearing. The link to sign up for the online testimony is boston.gov/citycouncil/google.asp. And we'll Skype you in for any questions, comments during the public testimony. And this will start immediately. And so for folks who would like to sign up for those opportunities, you can go online to the city website and sign up. With that, let me just also recognize we've been joined by Councilor at Large Anissa Asabi George. And with that, let me read the dockets into the record. Today's hearing is on dockets 0525 through 0527, 0537, and 0543. Orders for the fiscal year 17 operating budget, including annual appropriations and tax order. Annual appropriation for the school department, appropriation for other post-employment benefits, also known as OPEB, appropriation for certain park improvements, and appropriation for certain bridge projects. Also, our capital loan orders, dockets 0528 through 0532, 0534 through 0536, and 0538 through 0542. Orders for the fiscal year 17 capital budget, including loan orders, appropriations amending previous loan orders, and lease and purchase agreements. I'd like to welcome both Dave Sweeney, the CFO, and our budget director, Katie Hammer, for coming to provide today's overview. And thank you and your team for all the work going into today's presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. Today, we're proud to present a budget that fulfills the city's statutory responsibility of submitting a balanced budget. It's a structurally balanced budget that matches ongoing operating expenses and ongoing revenues, and a budget that enacts necessary reforms to address investment needs of core city functions such as education, public works, and public safety, but also modern municipal functions such as translation services, programs aimed at solving homelessness and treating addiction. This budget is not just a result of the deep dive that OBM has led since the fall, but also the consequence of a history of actions taken by this administration, previous administrations, and the city council. And it's also a consequence of factors beyond the city's control. When we started building this budget, we had no room for a single dollar of investment. In fact, just to achieve balance, millions in reductions, efficiencies, and reforms had to be found. Runaway cost structures had to be addressed. We solicited input regarding new spending from department heads beginning in December and from the City Council beginning in January. Based on the identification of needs beyond what we're currently providing, more savings were necessary than otherwise would have been required. If further investment is desired, additional reductions or revenues must be identified as well. Under our current operating structure, costs grow faster than revenues, and this is in a strong local economy and a stable national economy. Our second largest revenue source, state aid, is growing at less than 2% per year, not nearly keeping pace with city wage increases. It's in this context that we submit a balanced budget that we are very proud of. And I have a presentation that I'm going to walk you through with Katie, some of which will be familiar to you from the budget breakfast of a couple of weeks ago. So again, this balanced budget maintains high levels of support in critical areas such as education and public safety. And in fact, the three largest appropriation increases come in Boston Public Schools, the Fire Department, and the Police Department. This budget achieves efficiencies and savings. In order to make investments and achieve balance, we've had to make significant reductions, and we're very proud of the collaboration that's occurred across departments to identify these opportunities. This budget also makes limited strategic investments. These have been in part guided by the work done over the last 2 years and the operational reviews conducted by this administration. Seven major audits of major departments have provided a roadmap for some of these savings, as well as experience and new staff within this administration and some ideas from the council to identify opportunities to find savings and efficiencies that free up dollars for new investments. And Katie will, of course, go into this in more detail in a little while. We continue to address our long-term liabilities in a responsible way. This is why you see a $5 million increase in the pension expenditure projected for FY17, $40 million going to our $2.3 billion OPEB liability, and a $13 million increase in our debt service item to pay for pay for obligations as a result of past borrowing. This budget builds on the administration's record of strong fiscal management and also builds on the city's data-driven managerial approach to governance that was recently validated by the affirmation of Boston's AAA bond rating. In terms of details, I don't think it's any surprise to anyone that this budget relies very heavily on the city's property tax revenue to support its expenditures. Of the $2.97 billion in revenue, over $2 billion, or 68%, now comes from the property tax. About $432 million is projected for state aid, our second largest source of revenue. Our third largest source is excises, which would include room occupancy excise, hotel motel, motor vehicle excise, and meals tax. We're relying on $191 million in revenue from that source. There are smaller sources of revenue, such as fines, that we're relying about $60 million on, pilots, including the Massport pilot, about $44 million, licenses and permits, $55 million, departmental revenues of $55 million, and 121A and B payments of $44 million. So this $2.97 billion budget represents 4% or $115 million in growth from the FY16 budget. I alluded to the fact that our second largest source of revenue is state aid, far behind the property tax. In terms of providing some context as to where the fiscal challenges come from that the city faces, I think it's important to recall the history of our revenue breakdown over the last 15 years or so. So going into two recessions ago in about 2002, we received 30% of our revenue from state aid and just over half of our revenue from the property tax. The property tax reliance has continued to increase to the point that we're now relying on the property tax for over two-thirds of our revenue, while the percentage of our revenue comprised of state aid has been reduced by roughly half. So since 2008, which is kind of a benchmark year that we use a lot because of the recession that occurred around that time, property tax revenue has grown from $1.3 billion to now $2.017 billion in FY17. State aid in 2008 was $493 million and declined to a low of $390 million in 2012, and has somewhat rebounded since, and we're projecting $432 million, but notably is still nowhere near the level of gross state aid that we were seeing pre-recession. And I've probably hit on this point before in past presentations, but it's worth noting that the property tax is really our only major broad across the board tax revenue source that we have. We do not have the ability to tax income or sales other than on the meals tax in any real way. And this distinguishes us from some other major cities in the country, and it's one of the reasons why we're so heavily reliant on development. So speaking of which, of the $115 million in projected revenue growth in FY17, about $93 million of that is coming from the property tax. And so of that $93 million, about $49 million is growth allowable under Proposition 2.5, and about $44 million is attributable to new growth. By way of background, the levy on existing property can only grow by 2.5% per year. So even if, for instance, in your neighborhoods, you may hear about increases in assessed value. So since Mayor Walsh took office, property values have increased by 28% citywide. However, annually, the levy on those properties may only increase by 2.5% across the board. So you see some properties increase by more and some by less, but on average, 2.5%. So for the third consecutive year, we're projecting at least $44 million in new growth revenue. And this is significant, and to be blunt, is probably the only way we're able to get to a balanced budget is the strength of the local development economy with $7 billion of development under construction. If you look back to the period of 2010 to 2013, new growth was in decline, partially because of the international economy, and had stabilized at about $28 million a year. So broadly speaking, it's really as simple as that. We have about $16 million more per year as a result of this increased new growth, plus that compounds over previous year's new growth as well. So again, with over 80% of our revenue coming from two sources, I think it's important to focus on those two. And the story is very strong growth in property tax and extremely weak growth in state aid. So while gross state aid is projected to increase in FY17 by 1.9%, that really doesn't tell the whole story of what's going on with our state aid. Because what we receive on our cherry sheet is actually a net of our appropriated state revenue minus assessments for things such as our charter school assessment, our MBTA assessment being the other major one. So while we are projecting a 1.9% increase in gross revenue, we're actually projecting roughly flat net state aid this year. And this is actually in a strange way, a positive development compared to where we've been in previous years. And we've seen a $180 million decline in net state aid, a combination of stagnant state revenue and ever-increasing charter assessments. In terms of state education funding trends, so the primary source of state education revenue is Chapter 70, to which the city typically benefits from somewhere between $210 and $215 million per year in recent years. You can see on this chart, the red bars at the bottom represent what we've received in Chapter 70 aid over the last nearly decade. There's a graphic here that says, despite the state adding over $850 million since FY08, Boston's Chapter 70 aid is down by $2 million. You'll hear Katie and I say this a lot, but Chapter 70 doesn't really work for Boston. And the short story is, as more and more money gets pumped into state aid, gets pumped into Chapter 70 specifically, it does not necessarily result in Boston seeing more aid. You can see in the lines above that, the dashed black line represents what the city is required to spend on education by the state. This is supposed to be an approximation of what it costs to educate children in Boston. We're currently spending about $157 million more than is required in FY16, and this trend would likely continue at about this level in 17. We're not sure of the exact numbers yet. So essentially, the city has made up the gap being left by stagnant state aid. And I think it's notable that this is not the experience in every community, right? You can see that from the $850 million being added to Chapter 70, that some communities have seen a spike in Chapter 70 aid over the last decade or so, and some communities see a dramatically larger proportion of their school budget funded through state revenue. So statewide, Chapter 70 covers about 45% of district foundation budgets, whereas in Boston, it covers just 26%, and we actually spend well above our foundation budget anyway, so it's covering even a smaller proportion of what we're actually spending. A city like Lawrence, the state covers 95% of its foundation budget, Worcester 70%, Holyoke 88%, and we are actually receiving less of our foundation budget than a place like a town like Holliston at 30%. So I think it's notable in that the state continues to pump more and more money into these line items, and they do not benefit Boston. And when we're advocating for additional fundings, we need to be cognizant of which items work for Boston and which items do not work for Boston. This year in FY17, there's a $4.6 billion statewide Chapter 70 appropriation, and we're projecting somewhere again in that sort of 213 to 216 Chapter 70 range, a $72 million increase statewide, and we're projecting to see somewhere in the, you know, $1 to $4 million increase of that statewide, despite making up a larger proportion of the school population and larger proportion of the overall population, and having a very costly student population to begin with. So we receive about 4.7% of Chapter 70 aid statewide. Compounding this problem is that we are required to spend more and more every year on charter schools by state law. So we have no discretion. We are assessed this and is netted out of the revenue that we receive from the state, from our unrestricted general government aid, charter reimbursement, and Chapter 70 and other local aid sources. So if you look back, the experience since the 2010 achievement gap legislation was passed is we've seen a 131% or $90 million increase in our charter assessment. For a very long time, the state had kept pace with its obligation under the law to reimburse a certain portion of these costs. So the state, by statute, is required to reimburse 100% of first-year growth costs and then 25% of each subsequent year. But as the number, as charter costs and charter seats have expanded over the last 6 years, this has become increasingly unattainable for the state to fund, and it's now underfunded statewide by over $50 million and we're projecting a $16 million shortfall in terms of the state fulfilling its obligation in FY16 alone. In FY17, we are projecting our assessment to go up by about $11 million, and there's a great uncertainty about what our reimbursement will be at the state. We have advocated for financing reforms, and that's still being worked out, and in fact could be taken up by the House of Representatives today, this item. So with that backdrop, the administration has advocated for a gradual cap lift that would protect the city financially from continued growth in charter seats and charter costs. So the mayor has advocated for a direct financing mechanism that would protect the city against the risk of underfunding of charter schools by the state, and would also allow net school spending spent on charter schools to increase by about a half a percent per year once the existing cap is fully rolled out. There have been other proposals at the state. Most recently, the Senate passed legislation that would have followed a similar path, but only in instance, only in a scenario where certain recommendations related to Chapter 70 funding were fulfilled in advance. I think it's critical to note that the debate around increasing the cap or not increasing the cap is really not that simple, because we need a financing fix regardless of whether the cap is lifted at all. And we've continued to make that our sole point of advocacy, essentially, through the state budgeting process. The other large driver of costs, of course, is personnel cost growth, and this is a function of several things, wage increases, collectively bargained and otherwise, step increases, and also just the sheer number of employees. So the average annual increases post-recession have been about 4.2%. I think it's worth noting that appropriations are only growing when you net out health insurance and pension increases by 1.5% in this budget. So clearly this requires reductions in other places just to sustain the existing workforce. Also of note that Katie will get into, when you see the appropriations included in this recommendation for FY17 from the administration, there are some issues with comparability, because most appropriations do not include general wage increases for FY17, as many of our contracts are up. So we have included a collective bargaining reserve, but you would not see those anticipated costs in individual departments. So they look lower than they otherwise would be in other years due to that fact, with the exception of the fire department and public health's EMS unit. Healthcare cost growth has been a huge success story of the partnership between the state, both this city administration and the past city administration and the city council. We have passed two groundbreaking public employee committee agreements with our public employee unions that have really bent the curve on healthcare cost increases, and you can see that in this chart. There was a period of actual real dollar decline, but generally speaking, healthcare costs greatly outpace cost increases in other areas. And we're seeing a resumption of this in this year. We're projecting about a 5.5% increase in healthcare costs, despite $45 million agreement being signed about a year and a half ago that has altered employee premiums and copays and things like that, and despite several RFP efforts and just general ongoing efforts to reduce costs. There are some market factors, such as high-cost pharmaceuticals that are increasing costs by double digits, that are driving costs up this year. So in terms of how the additional revenue growth that we talk about, the $115 million referenced in growth from 16 to 17, about $12 million right off the top goes to this healthcare cost growth, in addition to the $32 million for other fixed costs. And then again, funding our long-term liabilities, I think I tend to focus on the pension and OPEB liabilities that combined are about $4 billion in outstanding liabilities incurred by the city over the past several decades. We are catching up on our pension schedule, which we plan to have amortized our unfunded liability by 2025, but this does require nearly an 8% increase to this appropriation every year, which is millions and millions of dollars year after year. And also our OPEB liability, we have a plan to continue to pay down $40 million a year plus PHC share, and then eventually transfer some of the payment we're making from transfer some of our pension payment over to OPEB once that liability is paid down in 2025. So in terms of overall approach, fiscal responsibility, this has been an enormous success story of Boston, and this is not something that we're seeing necessarily even statewide or nationally. We're in a very good position relative to some of our peers. We recently had affirmed our AAA bond rating with a stable outlook by both bond rating agencies that we utilize. But as I just spoke to, we do have continuing challenges that require a high degree of vigilance from the administration and the council to continue to increase revenues and keep costs under control. So we generally have, our approach has been conservative budgeting. This is a longstanding practice of the city. We seek not to run deficits in any given year, and we've been successful in doing that. We utilize cost containment efforts, such as our overtime management initiative that Katie's going to speak to, the PEC savings that we worked with our unions on that I spoke to earlier, as well as a robust personnel monitoring process through the PRC committee. We are also utilizing database management systems. It's been widely covered, I think, the mayor's use of dashboards and the city's longstanding bar performance management structure. Also, revenue maximization. This permeates, I think, throughout the city, whether it be at the transportation department, assessing on our seeking Medicare reimbursement rates, higher Medicare reimbursement figures. We also utilize long-term planning. We have many, many long-term planning efforts ongoing so that we can address the problems coming our way. This has been highlighted, I think, in the last couple of months at BPS specifically with the Build BPS Master Facilities Plan and the Long-Term Financial Planning Committee. But we also have Imagine Boston 2030, Go Boston, things like that. So again, strong and proactive fiscal management continues to be our practice here. And with that, I'll turn it over to Katie to get into the specifics of the FY17 budget.
Thanks, Dave. This budget builds on that record by more precisely budgeting expenditures. And you'll see this when we talk about that overtime budget, implementing operational review recommendations, our healthcare cost containment reforms that Dave spoke to that are estimated to save $45 million over the term of the last PEC agreement, and our continuation of budgeting in a conservative manner given some of the outstanding unknowns this year. In this budget, basically when the mayor came to office, he and his team, we began thoroughly reviewing government operations, and the administration found both opportunities for efficiencies and reform and also identified some needs for real investment. And it's only through achieving savings in this budget that we are able to make investments. And some of the savings that are being achieved here, I'll highlight $11.6 million in overtime savings in our public safety and streets cabinets. We're eliminating over 100 long-term vacant positions in city departments, which will save about $4.7 million without impacting service levels. We're achieving nearly $1 million in utility savings from reduced usage and lower rates. We're tightening our waste disposal budgets and other contracted services. The Public Health Commission has taken a couple of budget tightening measures, which will result in $1.4 million in savings. And BPS is reducing costs in several areas, including about $10 million in their transportation budget. So I wanted to make sure we explained over time what's going on here. As part of its reform to reduce overtime hours and provide real spending limits for especially the public safety departments, the Walsh administration is fully budgeting for public safety overtime for the first time in over 15 years. So previously, the true cost of public safety overtime was not apparent in the budget, as it was budgeted at an inadequate level and then accounted for through conservative budgeting and covered at the end of the year with surpluses. So if you look at FY15 for the police department on this graph, the blue and red line, the blue part of the bar shows how much we actually budgeted. And when you add the blue and red together, that is the amount that was actually spent, about $60 million in FY15. So this year, in FY17, we are properly budgeting for the police and fire department overtime budgets, but they are dramatically reducing the number of hours that they are going to be having overtime going into FY17. So the police has committed to cut overtime by 15% from FY15 levels, and the fire has committed to cut overtime by 5% from FY16 levels. So that is a dramatic savings in this budget. Specifically looking at police, this is saving $9.2 million. Without this reform, we'd be spending over $63 million on police overtime in FY17. As we look at the budget as a whole, we spend about 40% of our budget on education, this year 35% on Boston Public Schools and 5% on our charter school assessment. Public safety takes up another 19% of our budget, and then all the other departments fit into about 16% of the budget. That bottom part of the pie there, you can see from other centrally budgeted funds to other fixed costs. Those are centrally budgeted appropriations, and it's important to remember that this section of the pie supports the other programs. For example, our debt service supports our capital investments in our schools. Our pension payments support our police and firefighter employee pension benefits, and our collective bargaining reserve will go to fund collective bargaining agreements for all departments as they are negotiated. Again, Dave mentioned this a little bit earlier, but most departments do not have collective bargaining in their appropriation this year because most of the agreements will expire within the next 6 months. Only fire and EMS have negotiated collective bargaining agreement for FY17. For this reason, most departmental increases will look smaller. And if you look at the city departments, BPS, and Public Health Commission, netting out health insurance and pension costs, they're growing at about 1.5% over FY16 estimated spending. If you take out that bottom portion of the pie that was related to the health care, the other fixed costs, the pension, and the other centrally budgeted funds, you can see where we programmatically spend our funds. We are spending about, again, in our programmatic funds, about 52% of that money on education, 17% on police, and 10% on fire. All other departments are within that green slice, about 21%. We are extremely proud of our investment in education. Boston, like I said on the first pie, spends about 40% of our budget on education. And according to a report by the U.S. Census Bureau, Boston public schools invest more money per student than any of the 100 largest school districts in the nation. You will hear more about BPS's budget tomorrow, but I'll mention a few key investments and reductions. First, we are proud that Boston will be adding a more than 200 K-1 seats in this budget. In addition, there are a number of SPED investments, including improved data access for parents, classroom supports, and transition services for students aged 14 to 22. We're enhancing ELL services in this budget and adding 33 new classrooms at 18 schools. BPS is also maintaining their commitment to extended hours and professional development and other school-based supports as federal and state grants expire. BPS is also achieving efficiencies in transportation in this budget. They will be changing their SPED staffing ratios in a manner that is at or below state compliance. They are finding efficiencies in centrally budgeted support, and they're putting guardrails on their early hiring initiative. We are hopeful that the state will more fully fund the charter school reimbursement transition funding, a critical revenue for Boston, and one that Dave referenced earlier. If we receive that additional revenue above our budgeted levels, BPS is planning additional strategic investments, including Excellence for All and a transportation data system. And again, they can get into that a little bit more tomorrow. Because we were able to make savings in this budget, we have some great investments to be proud of. And I'm just going to kind of quickly go through those. First, again, we're really proud of the over 200 new K-1 seats in BPS this year. That is on top of the 200 that were added over the past 2 years. BPS is also investing in special education, as I just mentioned. And in housing, we have some really great housing investments in this, homelessness investments in this budget. $1.3 million in general funding towards the action plan to end chronic veteran homelessness, and that includes front door triage at Pine Street Inn, $900K for rapid rehousing rental assistance, and additional funding to for emergency shelter for families. In addition, we are investing at the Public Health Commission's Southampton Street and Woods Mullen homeless shelters to make sure that they have a nice level of public safety and additional services for the those who are staying there. We are launching Parks First this year. It is a comprehensive initiative ensuring that all Boston's open space is among the nation's most accessible and equitable. With that, we have both operating and capital investments, and I'll speak to some of the capital investments later, but on the operating side, we're going to have more seasonal park rangers and a larger seasonal maintenance workforce to make sure that our parks are welcoming and safe. We will have 9 early voting sites, one in each of your city council districts, to promote access to voting opportunities across the city. 311 call takers will be able to interact with constituents through an interpreter. Additionally, we will have the ability to translate written documents. And this comes out of the recommendations from the Communications Access Working Group, which Council President Wu worked on. We have an additional reform in this budget, which stems from, there are a number of investments and savings in this budget that come from the operational audits. One great example is DND's audit recommended that they focus more on their core mission. Coming out of that audit, we're doing a number of changes. We are moving the small business group over to economic development, and then economic development will also use grant dollars to invest in small business technical assistance. So it's really going to streamline access to small business resources through a single point of contact. We have a number of health and safety investments as well. One critical one, EMS will hire an additional class of 20 EMTs in order to increase the number of ambulances on daily shifts and reduce response times. This is something that we've actually heard from many of you as a key priority. Those seeking addiction treatment information will be able to reach the PHC PATHS program through 311 now. In addition, BCYF will use their existing resources to enable 5 centers to operate 7 days per week and allow 17 centers to operate 6 days per week. So they're better using their existing resources to provide services to the community. We are also revamping the fire engine and ladder replacement plan. This is another operational audit recommendation. We are going to replace 48% of the fleet within 4 years and 78% of the fleet within 8 years. The department will acquire 15 new apparatus in FY17.
Nice.
Another operational review recommendation is to rebalance the special collection stewardship responsibilities at the library. Working together with the associates, the public library will make this investment. We also have $1 million for Boston Artists, which was announced during the mayor's State of the City address. That includes artists in residence making individual grants to artists for a grant. And finally, the Office of Arts and Culture will have an artist resource desk. Public safety, we also have a number of investments in public safety modernization, including supporting the body camera pilot, revitalizing police radios, and upgrading E911. And we're also building on our data analytics success. Now switching over to the capital plan, we are building on the core goals identified in the Imagine Boston 2030 plan. We are launching projects that enhance neighborhoods across the city, improve mobility, support our schools, reinforce public safety, and make our buildings more energy efficient. This is through our Renew Boston Trust program. And this program will allow us to capture the savings from these projects and use those savings towards paying the debt service on this program. We also know that Build BPS, our school facility master plan, is in progress, and we have reserved capacity in this capital plan for future projects coming out of that plan. Just to take a quick look at where we spend our capital dollars, most of our capital program supports our roads and transportation infrastructure, and then also our schools. We also have large investments in our libraries, public safety, and parks. As I mentioned before, when I talked about parks first, we're really excited to launch this program, which I think some of the really big highlights on the capital side are the $5 million investment in Franklin Park Pathways, which will increase usage and safety. This park is an anchor for Jamaica Plain, Roxbury, and Dorchester. And this project is the largest park-only project in Franklin Park in close to a century. We also are excited to have a $3.5 million investment in Smith Playground in Alston, and a $3.7 million investment in Harambe Park. And this renovation will include environmental improvements, pedestrian pathways, field renovations, and entrance improvements, which will transform Harambe into a premier example of a community-led comprehensive planning process. There are a number of other major investments, including Noyes Park in East Boston, Garvey Playground in Dorchester, Martins Park in the Seaport, Paul Revere Mall in the North End, and Ramsay Park in the South End. Again, we're really excited about these investments. We also have heard from you and your constituents that the basics matter, and that's why this capital budget increases our resurfacing and sidewalk repair program by nearly $4 million. And bridge repair by over $6 million. This builds on the nearly 100 miles of roadwork performed over the last 2 years. We also heard from you that Vision Zero was important. This capital plan includes $3.1 million in Vision Zero to eliminate serious injuries and fatalities from our roadways. We also plan to include a number of comprehensive redesign of several squares, quarters, and public spaces throughout the city. And you can see the list here. It's quite comprehensive. We're really, this is going to be quite a game changer in a lot of those places. We are continuing our annual capital programs. I already mentioned our road, sidewalk, and lighting programs. But we're also, this is one of the places where we are investing in our engines and ladders, that apparatus replacement program I mentioned earlier. We're also completing IT infrastructure projects, such as expanding the city's fiber optic network to connect approximately 90 additional public schools, reducing costs and making more bandwidth widely available. We have a number of major ongoing projects right now in the capital plan, just a couple that I'm going to highlight. We'll be leveraging funds from the MSBA to replace windows at 7 schools, and we also have major school construction projects at the Dearborn and Elliott schools. The JP Library is under construction, and we are upgrading our police radio system. We'll be launching several new projects in FY17. I mentioned the parks ones before, but we're also very excited about the Adams Branch and Upham's Corner libraries, and we'll be studying a new North End Community Center as well. So to wrap up, we are really proud of the reforms in this budget. The mayor came to office and systematically reviewed reviewed government with operational reviews, data analysis, and planning efforts. We found that we face fiscal pressures that threaten to become unsustainable unless we change the way we do business. We also identified significant gaps that exist between demand for city services and those that we are providing. It is through that lens that we put forward this responsible budget. It is only through achieving savings in this budget that we are able to make targeted investments. And we know more needs to be done to address our longstanding challenges, and we look forward to working with you to make the changes and meeting Boston's residents' needs. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie. And let me recognize that we've been joined by Councilor-at-Large Ayanna Pressley. Before I open it up to the councilors, I was going to ask Sam Tyler to provide some brief comments on the budget, and then we'll open it up to councilors, at which time the usual ground rules are in play, 5 minutes for each councilor, and you know we'll have several go-arounds if necessary. But I'd ask, I'll keep my timer handy. And as Sam gets ready, I just want to, obviously, you know, the theme has been for many years, especially in my time as chairman of Ways and Means, that we do have a limited toolkit of revenue, property tax being the major source, the predominantly major source, a declining state aid. So I would just, you know, over the next several weeks as we review the budget, if there are other ways the council and the administration can work together on enhancing revenue sources and exploring that, you know, just let us know and keep us informed.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thanks. Hi, Sam.
Mr. Chairman, for the record, my name is Sam Tyler, president of the Boston Municipal Research Bureau, and I thank you for the opportunity to provide some brief comments to a very large budget. You know, this is the mayor's third budget after 2 years in office, and this budget continues to be built with conservative revenue estimates and fiscal discipline. It's also a very thoughtful budget from the 2 years' experience in office, from the advantage of the audit reports, and a better sense of departmental services, and understanding that in order, as was said, to achieve some of the initiatives, that savings and efficiencies need to be included in this budget more so than I think we've seen in the past, and I'll deal with that a little later. You know, it's important to know, I think, that one thing that had been said, that 93% of the revenue in this budget comes from city-owned sources, that it reinforces the point made in terms of the second largest revenue source not really growing with expenditures. But between the property tax and the other excise taxes, departmental receipts, permits, that makes up 93% of the total revenue budget. The property tax itself represents, as has been said, 68% of the total operational revenue, but 82% of the growth in the revenue for this next year. And to that point, which has also been said, I mean, it's the 2.5 increase in the base levy as a result of the fact that Boston's levy is below the levy ceiling, but it's also almost 2.5% increase because of development, new development, growth, or exempt property that becomes taxable. And that has made a big difference for the city over the past few years in terms of being able to provide better services. But it's also dependent on that the economic climate continue to be hot for development in Boston, and the pipeline is full, but it is still a concern that it's too much of a reliance on one single revenue source. State aid, the second largest revenue source, I guess the gross estimate is $432.2 million, which has been said is a 1.9% increase. Never mind, you know, what net state aid would be. So state aid represents 14.5% of the total revenue of this budget, but only 7% of the revenue increase. The high reliance on the property tax is really, as I said, due to state aid not keeping up with the pace of spending. So you've had numbers in terms of what the trends have been since fiscal 2008. I'll give you a shorter time frame, but I think it's the same message. So the 5 years from fiscal 11 to fiscal 16, total general fund spending has increased by 22%. During that same time, the property tax increased by 27.8%, but state aid, gross state aid, only increased by 7%. Boston School Department spending has increased by 23%, and if you were to take out health insurance, it would be 35%. But state aid for education, Chapter 78, has only increased by 4% over those 5 years. The excise tax revenues have been growing, but they represent a small percentage of the total revenue, so they represent 6.4% of the total revenue and 10% of the growth. We've reviewed, you know, the revenue estimates in the time that we've had so far, and feel that they are reasonable. They are, I think what I said last year holds true, they're comfortably conservative, as they need to be. You know, we don't know what collective bargaining will bring this year. Hopefully these contracts will be negotiated this year. The new approach for police and fire overtime is commendable, but, you know, I think the city needs to be ready just in case. Execution of courts, the appropriation there is higher, but that's still less than what was spent the year before. And we can't forget, you know, the snow removal example of last year. On the spending side, $2.97 billion seems like a lot, but out of over 50 budget accounts, only 10 accounts represent 87% of the total budget that's recommended. The four departments, the large departments of school, police, fire, public works, represent $1.7 billion, or 58% of the total budget. And there are then the benefit and mandatory accounts that represent 29% of the budget, but 40% of the increase. Included in these mandatory expenses are health insurance, pensions, debt service, the OPEB reserve, state assessments, which are, as you know, primarily assessments for charter tuition assessment, as well as the MBTA assessment. But together, these four departments and approximately six benefit mandatory accounts total $2.6 billion, or 87% of the total budget. That only leaves about $383 million, or 13% of the budget, for the remaining 44 city departments and other non-departmental accounts. Just to go in, because of the fact that the health or the benefit and mandatory expenses are increasing, represent 29% of the budget, but are increasing by 40%, it's worth noting some of the details. Health insurance is going to increase by $10.5 million. That's an increase over what we've seen in the past as a result of steps taken by the administration, as well as legislation regarding Medicare enrollment requirements. Debt service is increasing by $13.4 million, or 8%. As you'll see, the city is planning to borrow more or put more in. State assessments increased by $12.3 million. So that's where a lot of the growth is that their city doesn't have a lot of control over. What's interesting to know is pensions, which would normally increase by 8% because of the city's intent on reaching full funding by 2025, but this year in the budget, it's an increase of $5.3 million, or 2.9%. And so part of that is, as will be explained in future hearings, I think, the fact that the city has made a decision, which is a really good decision in terms of the Boston Water and Sewer Commission being more responsible for its pension costs, since a much larger percentage of the workforce now are individuals who never work for the city. And so it makes sense to do that, and it is a benefit to the city. And you know, the city will reimburse the Water and Sewer Commission for those remaining city employee or Water and Sewer Commission employees who formerly worked for the Public Works Department still working there. So that's a very important initiative that will have long-term benefits. Employees and benefits account for almost 78% of the total appropriation in this budget, and which will require continued discipline management over personnel levels and expenses. Not expanding manning levels or benefits in the collective bargaining negotiations that are underway will be important. The budget does provide for 175 new positions by January of 2017. Some of that is a timing issue in terms of police class. The other issues, which have already been noted in terms of 20 new EMTs for the Public Health Commission, there are an increase in 64 in the school department. So these are all issues that, you know, need to be carefully watched. I think what's notable about this budget is the efficiencies and savings that are incorporated into the budget and the thoughtful thinking behind that. Just a few examples, some of which I think we've already heard, but, you know, transferring the Neighborhood Business Service from D&D to economic development makes sense, like issues coming together. Merging the licensing board and the Consumer Affairs and Licensing Department makes sense now that the mayor has appointment approval over both. Moving Emergency Shelter Commission from the Public Health Commission to the Department of Neighborhood Development, so housing stays together. What's been noted about truing up overtime expenses for police and fire department, bringing back the recreation section from BCYF to the Parks Department, splitting property and construction management department into a property management department and a separate public facilities department, transferring the Animal Control Commission from property management to inspectional services, and then the transferring environmental monitoring program from Public Works to the Parks Department. I'll only end with a recommendation for the Ways and Means Committee that I would suggest at two different times during the course of the year that it review this budget and the estimates that have been that are part of this budget and how that is playing out. You know, probably in January after the tax rate is set in December and perhaps in May, is just the ongoing monitoring by this committee of sort of the operations of the budget and departmental services. So with that, I'll conclude.
Thank you. Sam, can you provide your testimony in writing?
Sure.
That I can distribute to some folks who couldn't be here right now.
I'll be happy to.
Great, thanks. Well, thank you, and thanks, Dave and Katie, for that very comprehensive presentation. I'm gonna hit on a couple of things and then pass it off to my colleagues. The collective bargaining, you know, we talked about this, two unions that are under contract through 17, I believe, and then 38 or so that we're bargaining with currently. And I think I saw about $13 million for FY17 collective bargaining reserve. Is that going to grow, or is that pretty much what you're shooting for? Because again, I know you have to base it on estimates.
Yeah, I mean, it's not, we're not anticipating it growing as part of this budget approval process. It doesn't represent a specific pattern, but we think combined with our approach to revenue, that amount makes sense for FY17.
Right.
It's obviously largely dependent on the wage patterns that are agreed to or arbitration awards if that becomes necessary. We're comfortable with the 13 for now.
Million. Yep. Okay. I think what stuck out at me was if we did nothing differently and we just funded the budget, the same budget as last year, we'd basically be even again, right? 4.2% or 4.4% in revenue growth but 4.2% in personnel costs?
I think, actually, in order just to achieve balance, we had to come up with some, I think, probably 8 figures worth of reductions just to get to balance. Mm-hmm. And then in order to fund some of the initiatives and investments that Katie spoke to, we had to go a little bit deeper. So if nothing had been done and we had merely rolled forward today's costs into next year, we would not have had a balanced budget. Right.
You'd still need more revenue.
We would need more revenue.
Or
we would have
less
to cut expenditures.
Right. Well, and again, this has been a constant theme since I've been on this body. We're a healthy city. We rely heavily on property tax. We have a great bond rating, and it's because of the conservative nature with which we budget with. But I would also say it's about sustainability. And, you know, I agree with those who say that, you know, budgets are a value statement. They're a statement of our priorities, but we also have to prioritize and put a great deal of emphasis on living within our means for the future generations and for the taxpayers. So, you know, I appreciate laying this out for us. And as we go forward, you know, I look to my colleagues to have their imprint on this, the folks who are viewing, who attend our hearings, to have an imprint on this process. And just wanted to thank you. And with that, let me recognize Councillor Tim McCarthy. Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you, Councillor. thank you very much for your presentation. I know we've gone over a lot of this before, and most of the questions I have will be directed to the department. The one question I did have, I know you're both well aware that I've had my issues with the MBTA lately. What is our assessment to the MBTA? Do you know? Ballpark?
I think it's $83 million.
$83 million? Okay. Okay. Because they continue to hammer my constituents in District 5 with unfair pricing. So I want to continue to make sure that they realize how much the City of Boston contributes to their welfare. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Councilor McCarthy. Councilor O'Malley.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Katie, Dave, thank you for another thorough overview. I just have a couple of sort of procedural questions. You know, a lot of education questions that I have, and I know the bulk of which will be better answered by the superintendent and his team, but can you just sort of explain more about the Chapter 70 aid, and I think it's on page 8 where you show that the graph which reflects the charter assessment, which is in blue, the red which is the reimbursement, then the white which I believe is the unfunded piece, the unfunded obligation.
Sure. So I think you had it exactly right. The blue, the entire bar represented by the top portion that's in blue represents what we are assessed annually by the Commonwealth for students from Boston who attend charter schools.
Okay.
So that's projected to grow to $158 million in 2017, about an $11 million increase from this year.
And does that mean, and I'm sorry, forgive my ignorance, but I just want to make sure I have this right, because I think it's probably among the more complicated things we'll talk. So $11 million over fiscal 16, is that because there are more seats, or just like anything that salaries, et cetera, grows?
It's both. So our assessment depends both on the number of kids sitting in seats that are projected to sit in seats at charter school. So that is projected to go up by about 600 or so next year. And then in addition, our charter school rate is based on the amount that we spend really on education in general. So as we spend more at BPS, we actually spend more on our charter school assessment as well. There's this portion of our charter school assessment that's called the above foundation spending rate, and it's the percent of our budget that we spend on, it's the percent that we spend above what we're required to. and that percent is applied to the charter school.
And that is, that's the another slide that shows it's we far exceed the
that's
the rate.
Right. So we, I think, are above found. We spend 26% more. Our charter school rate is 26% more than what it otherwise would have been because of our above foundation spending.
And you were talking, I think, Katie, either you or Dave, about other municipalities where it's significantly lower. It's under the rate, the Lawrences, the Lowell, et cetera.
So some of those, there are some communities that spend exactly what they're required to. Yeah. And for those communities, if they send students to charter schools, they spend, that rate is the kind of foundation rate that is the charter school tuition rate. They don't have that above foundation spending applied.
Councillor, just for clarification, I was noting the percentage of communities' foundation budgets that were provided by the Commonwealth, actually. So, like, Lawrence has 95% of its foundation budget paid by the Commonwealth. We only have about a quarter. And that's based on the way that Chapter 70 treats us as a rich community, essentially, and does not recognize necessarily, in our view, the needs of our student population. So our Chapter 70 tends to only increase by the minimum aid that the state provides every year, a minimum aid increase. So this year, I think we're looking at between $20 and $55 per pupil based on our current understanding of where the budget's going, whereas other communities may see different fluctuations based on how they're treated by the formula.
And this was, I was at the Mass Municipal Association meeting about a year or so ago out in Worcester, and this was the main point of conversation. Got to that very point, is that we are seen as a rich community, probably because of our property tax revenue, et cetera, when in fact the student population in traditional BPS is often lower income. So it sort of creates this duality, which can make things frustrating. And I'm not looking to get into the charter debate, but only to underscore the point that as we talk about our commitment to public education, there's sort of these external factors that we cannot control that further exacerbate budget shortfalls going forward.
Councilor O'Malley, if I could add,
yep.
I guess our most recent special report from the Research Bureau on charter school financing, you'll find a very good explanation of Chapter 70, how that's determined by the state, net school spending, and the showing that Boston is spending far more than it is than the state would require for adequate education for the students. And in terms of the comparison with other cities, yes, wealth is a factor, both property wealth as well as income wealth. And so Boston is basically required to fund on it from its own sources the maximum amount, and that puts it in a group with probably 40 other communities in Massachusetts. That's why a Lawrence that doesn't have the property wealth is receiving more state aid than Boston is. Boston is expected to raise the full amount of its own resources for education under the formula.
Sure.
But I think you'll find the report helpful.
Yeah. No, I get it. And I think that's one of the frustrating things I hear from constituents and chairs, that we're told we spend so much, yet we're still hearing all these programs and positions that are cut. It's one of the difficult things that we hope to reconcile. When you talked about the BPS budget, one of the reductions is putting guardrails on early hiring. Can you just explain a little bit more? Is that just to what that means?
Right. So the early hiring initiative is their initiative to allow this mutual consent process that I'm not quite sure you've heard about from BPS. And let me also say that BPS will be able to speak to this much,
sure,
much better tomorrow.
Completely understand. Yeah.
But they have a number of tactics that they are thinking of, that they are trying to employ to reduce the cost of their excess teacher pool.
Okay, maybe we can get to more specifics with them. Love the idea about streamlining the overtime cost for police and fire. I think that's very smart. And I also think that you're being maybe a little liberal with that approach, which is a good thing rather than to sort of undercut it, but it's already recognizing some savings, so I applaud you and the mayor for that. Similarly, the Parks First initiative is terrific. Anything we can do to grow that. Really am thrilled to hear about the early voting sites in every district in the city. What's the process of identifying those districts?
You know, I'm not really sure. I can get back to
it. Well, I would just ask. I'm sure my colleagues, I don't presume to speak for them, but I'm sure they'd agree that particularly for the district counselors, if we can help identify those, but it's a terrific thing. Similarly, some of the streamline access and translation and interpretive services is a very good step in the right direction, and we look forward to more questions as we proceed. So thank you. For being here. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor LaMartina.
Good afternoon, Chief. Katie, congratulations on this budget.
Thank you.
This is my 10th budget. And so my colleagues, if you have questions, come early, because most of the time they ask the questions. But here's a concern I've been every single year during budget time. As you know, I come from the transportation department. And again, I think we're losing out on a good opportunity and collecting revenues for the city with meters. Every time I visit another city around this country, I check out their meters. Most major cities, their meters, the price of park is more expensive than Boston, and the hours of operation, some of them go to 24 hours and some go to 2 in the morning. I just don't understand why we have not looked at that. I know the mayor, I think it was in October, he floated an idea about increasing the meter feeds, and there was some backlash. And I was in, where was I, in Chicago, and I have pictures on my phone of the price over there, an hour, some places $3 an hour, some $4 an hour. I just don't understand why we're not tapping into that revenues. I saw the story today in the Globe about the new meters, mm-hmm. And they're working, finally. I love hearing that. So can you explain why we are not looking at?
So to my knowledge, we are continuing to look at it, and that BTD and the Chief of Streets are continuing to look at variable pricing with mm-hmm. the meters. So I think you referenced some backlash. I think there's just some work that needs to be done to fully flush out what makes sense for Boston. But I don't think that's something that's been ruled out. And I think that cabinet has a lot of initiatives going on that can potentially improve quality of life, but also as a side effect could increase revenue to the city as well. On meters, we would always caution that the use of the meter revenue is limited to specific purposes. However,
no, I understand that, but you could use it for the transportation yes. department, which frees up money to use it in the parks department.
Absolutely.
So I think, I'm saying this because when I worked as director of operations, I wanted to get new meters and multi-space meters, and that's in 2001. And it took me 5 years to finally get it, and I was finally on the city council, because they told me, oh, you had to go to the city council, and it's in the meter fund. And I'm on the city council now. So I understand about the meter fund. So that's revenues that we could use in the transportation department, which frees up revenues that we could spend in the parks department. So I wish you will look into that.
We will.
Thank you. And then another concern I have is you eliminate 100 long-term positions. Can you explain me where those positions are?
A number of those positions are in the are in transportation, public works, and library.
Again,
these are positions that had been vacant for several years, and so by eliminating them, we are freeing up budgeted funds to direct towards some of the investments that we've highlighted.
So again, I have concerns when you're eliminating positions in the transportation department, particularly enforcement officers, because I can tell you now that in some neighborhoods we only have one enforcement officer, and they're busy writing tickets out for street cleaning, and there's public safety violations that are not getting tagged. So I don't understand why we would eliminate enforcement officers from the transportation department and the public works department.
These are positions that have gone unfilled for over a year at least, and some cases many 4 or 5 years. So this is not recent turnover. This is actually a general, pretty consistent with the force that we've been having.
So
no, I get that. I get that. But I know that there are enforcement officers that are vacant slots in the enforcement division that are not being filled, and I just don't understand it. It was like when I was working in the operations department with meters, they wouldn't let me hire repairmen, meter repairmen. It's like, why wouldn't you want to do that to get revenue? So these are old experience that I have. I just want to bring it to your attention, Chief. It just doesn't make sense to me.
So I think first off, thank you. And we are certainly open to modifying our projected FTEs if we think there's an opportunity to provide additional services or additional revenue that can provide additional services. I think, as Katie alluded to, under these particular, with this particular initiative, there's no reduction in actual force that we projected to be filled, but we will go back and look and see if there are opportunities to increase revenues with any positions.
I appreciate it if you go back and look in the transportation department.
Sure.
Because I know for a fact that I get calls from my constituents telling me, oh, there's all these cars parked mm-hmm. on hydrants, double parking, and we don't have the manpower. So it just doesn't make sense. But I appreciate you listening. This is my 10th time saying that. Can you just explain to me how you're going to cut overtime, streamline overtime in the police and fire, the costs? How you doing that? I just don't understand how you're doing that.
Do you mean by, you mean what are the actions that they're taking?
Yeah.
Yeah, so one of the really exciting things is that through work with the mayor, the Boston Police Department has already started cutting their overtime costs, their overtime hours from FY15 to FY16. We're already seeing a 10% reduction in overtime hours. That is largely from looking at some of the court overtime and from looking at staffing. And really trying to make sure that they have a good assessment of where that is. So this is something they've been working on really actively. The work to date has already been successful. We have gone to CompStat meetings to meet with their staff and really make sure that this is a focus. And I think the departments are committed to making this happen in FY17.
And I would just add, I think Number one, the fact that the police is already engaged in this and has had some early success gives us optimism that we can pull this off. Also, the number of pure hours is up pretty significantly over the last 5 years or so. So I think that gives us some comfort that there is some room to manage it. And the early signs are that that is the case. So.
Thank you. I appreciate the work you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Jackson.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and I appreciate the chair having the same opinion. I do believe that a budget is a value statement, so we're on the same page there. I guess when we look at those values, so we know that there's an $8 million surplus from snow. What's going to be the aggregate surplus that you are looking at the end of the year?
For 16, I think the only surplus we're currently anticipating is the snow surplus. So we're looking to end the year in balance at this point.
So you're saying a balance of $8 million?
It's too early to say. We're comfortable that we will achieve the $8 million surplus necessary for the parks initiative. Otherwise, we're not anticipating at this point any additional surplus.
So I guess my first question would be, with the opportunity to use capital budget for parks, why would you not allocate the $8 million to the schools, and why would you use it in the parks department when parks could be funded from the capital budget?
So a couple things there. One, this is a one-time surplus, and it would be irresponsible to ongoing operating costs based on one-time surplus. So for that reason, we took a one-time surplus and put it with a one-time capital investment. The other thing is that our capital budget is constrained by our debt affordability limits. And as we look towards the Build BPS, very large initiative going on right now, we need to make sure that we have capacity maintained in our capital budget for the recommendations coming out of that. So there's a couple of things going on there. One, we really want to make sure we're fiscally responsible and match ongoing revenues with ongoing investments and not take one-timers. One-timers are the type of thing that when our bond rating agencies look at us, they look down at that type of thing. So we need to make sure that we really match one-time surplus with one-time expenditures.
But I guess, well, I guess you use the word irresponsible. What I would say, if I were channeling the 4,000 families that are waiting to get into kindergarten, I would say taking that opportunity to bring more kindergartners is irresponsible. I really do believe that. I think that it makes much more sense to use capital for capital and operations for operations, even if it is one time. And I guess my next question would be, if we were to have, instead of going to 1.53% effective rate, what would the proposition 2.5 at max be? What would the revenue look like if we had gone to 2.5%?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
So a tax rate is, you didn't take the maximum?
Yes, we did.
So you took the 2.5%?
Yeah.
Yes.
And the valuations, you adjusted the valuations, but you did not you went all the way up to the 2.5%?
Yes.
Okay. The other question I guess I would have relative to the spending for FY16, what's your, blue bar on FY16 for the charter
assessment?
Yes. What is that dollar-wise?
When you look at that line, you need to look at the blue, the whole bar is our assessment. It's $158 million.
For 17?
Yep.
And 16 so what's 16? Would be 146?
146 is the budgeted amount, yeah.
So
a little over 11 million rounded in growth.
Okay. And I guess I would just say, you know, you guys continue to use census numbers, and they make no sense because census numbers are comparing us to states that don't have no foundation budget. And so if we really want to put us in context, Cambridge, which is right next to us, they spent $27,000 per pupil. And by the way, they're actually really proud of it. And instead of us being ashamed of our spending on our schools, I think we should actually be very proud of that, and we should be moving towards advocating for the Foundation Budget Review Committee the suggestions to be instituted, because it doesn't take into account the SPED and healthcare. And also, I would just note, you know, we're looking at Lawrence and other cities. I think it is critical to note that we are in a much better financial situation based on land versus those other cities. Did you have?
So I was just going to say, we are extremely proud of our investment in education, and
I think when we reference per pupil spending, we say that with pride, and we're providing a lot of this information in to provide context in considering the city budget and the BPS budget as well. I know there are many different reports that come up with many different per pupil spending numbers. There are many communities you can look to for comparison. I know if you look at Cambridge, they have extremely high out-of-district placement costs that drive their per-pupil costs. There are a lot of different cost structures. We have a much different scale. I think we're more than six times the size of Cambridge. But we talk about the amount we spend on BPS with pride, and we're very proud that the largest increase in an appropriation from 17 to 16 projected spending in this recommended budget is in BPS yet again.
The other thing I would just add is that when you look at the Foundation Budget Review Commission recommendations, the recommendations of those committees, as we have done the analysis of it, will not provide additional revenue to Boston. So we need to be very careful when we look at those recommendations and we think about where the best places to advocate for additional state revenue.
What is the dollar increase to the police budget and the fire budget?
Cumulatively, it's $10 million total from FY16 projected to FY17.
Is that both?
Combined, yeah.
Okay.
So
and the dollar for schools is $13.5 million?
Correct. Remember, yeah. The fire department does have a collective bargaining increase in their line item, and the school department and the police department do not this year.
Mm-hmm. And police department department, of course, has an annualization of collective bargaining awards that have been approved, body camera pilot, radio replacement, and a number of other initiatives as well.
Also, the annualization of the cadet program is a cost for the police department in this year, because that is being implemented starting in later in this fiscal year.
Has there been an analysis on the police relative to what it would mean to hire more officers versus the overtime that we currently have?
So,
yeah, well, for one thing, we actually are picking up, as Katie alluded to, 40 cadets this spring. We're also absorbing 15 additional police that are coming off of the COPS grant. If you look traditionally, I know we've spoken about this here before, there isn't necessarily the correlation you would expect between overtime and an increase in force at the police department. Overtime expense and hours have increased sort of regardless of force over time. But we continually evaluate needs within every department, but that might not be the savings that one would expect.
Okay. And you're noting that the budget is going up 4% as a whole in total?
4% is the total expenditure increase from 16 budgeted to 17 budgeted, okay, including, you know, $11 million charter, 13 debt service, health and insurance. And
when you look at estimated increase over FY16 estimated spending, though, that's a 3.3% increase.
Okay. But the schools are still not going up at the same rate. They're going up at a 1.35% rate, where the aggregate is going up at a nearly 4%, right? Is that true?
So, well, I think $32 million in growth off the top is from fixed costs. So what you have occurring, as occurs in many years, is your fixed costs increase at a much greater rate than your actual appropriation costs. Additionally, BPS is the largest department that does not have an across-the-board wage increase factored into its FY17 budget at the moment. So if wage increases are in fact bargained for, that number is likely to increase as well.
And you're putting money aside for that in a
reserve.
Okay. So that there's the 1.35% $13.5 million increase. What was the increase for BPS over the past 2 years during the Walsh administration?
I believe it was 38 and 39 million. Okay. If I recall.
So does 38, 39, and now you're a third of those. You had someone who was doing that budget for over 41 years. You have someone who's brand new doing the budget. So can you help explain why we are cutting our increase in the commitment to education by nearly 30 some odd million dollars versus what the initial need was assessed at 50 million. But so you have 38, 39. So we're heading in one direction, and then there's a huge fall off.
So one factor obviously is that collective bargaining that we just spoke of that makes that not an apples to apples comparison year over year. I think also, looking back, the story of a large budget deficit being solved at BPS is kind of an annual recurring story, and the cut amounts that you reference have similarly been taken on in past years as well. I would argue that the administration continues to make BPS its number one priority. It's now received almost a $90 million, if this budget is approved, appropriation increase over 3 years, far exceeding all other departments combined. So I don't view this as a decline in support for BPS at all. And in fact, the BPS appropriation continues to go up absent collective bargaining, even as charter costs continue to increase, which is in conflict with the state's theory as to what should happen to a school department's budget as charter costs go up.
I would just simply say that I do view it very differently, because we were looking at increases at 38, 39, and now we're at 13. And then when we went back and looked at Mayor Menino's commitment in the toughest days, in essentially our generation's Great Depression, the increases were higher than what we're talking about right now. In addition, the charter component definitely does hurt us, but I think the other component is with $115 million in new revenue, I think we should figure out a way to do right by the young people in the Boston Public Schools. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Can I just actually respond to that last point? Because I'm not quite sure you have correct data on that, the increases during the Menino administration. In FY10, the increase over FY09 actuals was $7.8 million or 1%. In FY11, it was $3.5 million or 0.4%. And in FY12, it was under $10 million or $1.2 million over FY11 actuals. So I guess I would just ask that you double check those numbers.
And I'll do that. And I guess I would ask that you double check the fact that $38 million, $39 million, and $13 million, we can say that our budgets go up annually. If they go up $1, that's actually the highest that we've ever spent in the city's history. But when it comes to actually doing right by the young people, the autistic students who are actually receiving class size increases. And Mr. Chair, I'll just note, I actually spoke recently to Council O'Malley's constituents. She moved to Brookline, and in Brookline, they actually have two full special ed teachers in her child's autistic classroom that has 10 students, and they have five paras. This is at the same time that we're now telling autistic parents that they're going to share paras in those classrooms. That is a real cut in service. It is a real retreat from the needs of our parents, and it leaves us with instability. And the only answer that continues to be put forward is to close schools, which I think is not leadership to say that we're going to close schools without investing fully in the Boston Public Schools. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Council Baker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, Dave, Katie, Sam. Good morning. Council Lamantina had spoke about the 100 vacated positions. We get into those a little bit. Are there any layoffs this year over and above those 100 positions?
We're not anticipating any layoffs that are directly driven by the budget. Obviously, at any point in time, there are hires and layoffs as well, but no large-scale layoff or anything that we're balancing the budget on.
Right.
There's some restructuring going on within individual departments, like the DND and economic development change. And then, as Councillor LaMattina and Sam spoke to, there's the elimination of over 100 long-term vacant positions, and then the addition of about 175 positions elsewhere. So essentially eliminating positions that are no longer useful in our opinion, and replacing them with positions necessary to operate the modern city.
And where are the 175 positions?
There,
and sorry if you've already answered this,
so
I stepped out of the room.
I should say 175 projected, 175 FTE projected increase to be filled in this fiscal year. We get into some semantics sometimes when we're talking about positions, I guess, but I believe 65 of them are in, they're across the board, but 65 are at BPS. They're projecting their number of filled FTEs to go up by 65 next year. Also, there's the cadet class at police, the 15 coming off the COPS grant. There are 20 EMTs. There are 20, roughly 20 associated with the closure of Long Island, bringing people back, moving to a different staffing model at PHC.
And will they'll go over public health? Okay.
This is related to those investments we discussed at Woods Mullen and the shelter on South Hampton Street.
Yeah, so those are the positions that will be right down on South Hampton Street
exactly.
to help support everything
exactly.
that's going on down there.
Exactly. Public safety positions as well as service level positions as well.
Okay. And in the restructuring you talked about, Dave, will people be losing their jobs there, D&D, in places like that, or?
You know what, I'll have to get back to you on that, but what I can say is, you know, there's no large-scale layoff on which this budget is balanced.
Okay, so like when you go in and you say we're going to eliminate these long-term vacant positions, who is that just like the department head says, yeah, we can do without that? Do we drill down at all and ask the people, the supervisors that are, you know, short-staffed? And like how far down do we go to make those determinations?
This was part of our budget process this year. We flagged these positions when we went out to our departments. And as they submitted their budgets back to us, they said, you know, yes, we can eliminate these positions. These ones are more challenging for us. So they did have ample opportunity to provide that feedback. And there are a lot of long-term, there are a few long-term vacant positions that we took off that list because there was a real departmental service level need.
Yeah, so there was a back and forth in which we initially identified this universe of positions that had been vacant for a long period of time and then consulted with departments about whether they truly could be eliminated, and some of them were retained at that point. But I think we've talked about this. On average, these have been vacant for several years, and in many cases they had been created but never filled as well.
Okay. We talked about state contributions, and I heard the number $185 million, but then there's another contribution. So do they contribute in the general fund, the $185 million, then more when it comes to Chapter 70 and all the school reimbursements? And if so, what are the two amounts? What does the state give us? And then what is our share that we put into the state coffers? So are we in a negative as what we contribute to the state?
So when we talk about state aid, that does include unrestricted general government aid, Chapter 70, charter reimbursement. Those main buckets that we talked about do all come to the general fund before we eventually rely on that revenue for expenditures. So,
and that's $185 million total from the state?
No, I think, are you referencing...
So the total of that is $432 million?
Okay.
Yes. So about $200... We're budgeting $214 million for Chapter 70, so that's roughly half of our total state aid. We have done some calculations in the past where we've estimated that we contribute about 20% of state tax revenue. I think state tax revenue is up over $20 billion now. So yes, we are a net contributor to the state.
So we're not getting nearly what we're putting in to the state.
I mean, I the way we talk about it, typically, as we receive, we contribute about 20% to state tax revenue. We're about 10% of the state's population, and we get 5-7% of the local aid.
Okay.
From the state, so.
That hole that we have in the cap, the charter cap, is there any plan into how we can tighten that up, or what's the plan in moving forward? If that's just going to widen, especially if they lift the cap, and we're going to get more and more charter schools, that white pot is just going to get bigger. What is that plan moving forward?
This is a critical piece of the mayor's education reform package that he proposed last fall. This financing problem, that white hole that you're describing, is the financing problem that we talk about. The fact that the Commonwealth has not fulfilled their obligation to fully funding the charter school reimbursement, which is a critical transitional funding mechanism for communities as they transition. And the Commonwealth has not fulfilled their obligation of funding it. The mayor proposed what we call a direct funding mechanism, which would have reduced our overall assessment and made made the Commonwealth basically would have funded that portion directly to the charter schools. So it would have made that no longer subject to appropriation for us.
For a city appropriation, they go directly to the charter school.
It would have gone from the Commonwealth directly to the charter schools. Not right now. It goes, our state aid revenue comes to us. It is then assessed from us out to the charter school. So we don't have the opportunity to appropriate it, and we are challenged because that charter school reimbursement is subject to appropriation by the Commonwealth, and that has been what they have underfunded. The mayor proposed a mechanism that would both directly fund it and provide more relief to communities like us that spend a larger portion of our education on budget on charter schools.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about what we foresee for EMS? I know you had the 20 new hires, but I believe in the past they were operating shorthanded when it came to supervisors and command staff and that sort of stuff. So will those 20, will we be able to fill some of those spots that were left vacated, the supervisors and the command staff and those sort of higher level positions? Will they push people up?
I think at the moment we're anticipating those position being the line EMTs. We did add a position to the command staff in the FY16 budget, but mm-hmm. we have to check with PHC and see where that stands.
Okay, that's a bit of a concern for me. What is our collective bargaining reserve? How much do we foresee going into that for next year?
So I think it's about $13 million we have budgeted.
Oh, I just got a snap over there. Okay, I don't know that. Yeah,
that was loud.
Okay, 1 minute.
Yeah, so we funded the collective bargaining reserve. I think it's about an $11 million increase, so about $13 million.
Okay, so just a little bit more. What is the cost of the cadet class? What is the cost of the body cam pilot? And also, do we have some kind of budget for new cameras, brick cameras installed around the city? Those three questions there.
So the body cameras is about $500,000, which includes the pilot as well as some transitional funding as well. And then let me, for the cadet program, it's going to take me a second to find this answer. We might have to follow up with you tomorrow. It was an investment that was in the budget last year, and I need to make sure I can find the annualized cost.
So yeah, you can send that to me offline. Okay. So that will be one class this year, and then...
No, it's the FY16 class.
Yeah.
But because it started so late in the fiscal year, the full year cost of it will be realized in FY17. So it's an increased amount that we have to spend on it this year, but there's not a new class this year.
So no new class for this upcoming year.
I think we anticipate that the initial class will last for 2 years, actually.
Right.
So it's a 2-year program with this class.
Okay.
And it's
okay.
Just beginning this spring.
And last question was camera budget. Do we have any budget for cameras, additional cameras in the city that would be brick cameras and not traffic cameras?
So one thing we are doing in this budget is that we are increasing a little bit of funding for the back end support that's required for the cameras program. There's just some additional infrastructure, you know, with cameras come infrastructure maintenance, and that was a key place that the police department said that they need some additional support this year.
Okay. Well, I already got snapped at, so I have to.
I apologize for that. Councilor Wu.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and hello, everyone. My voice is back a little, but not fully, so I'll keep it quick. Just on all the moving pieces and the timeline. So when will, you know, everything that all the question marks that you're waiting on from the state and other sources, and how much is likely to change?
I think, unfortunately, that's a great unknown. I mentioned that the House of Representatives kicks off its budget process today. Oftentimes they take up local aid and education issues early in the week. I'm not sure if that's going to, I don't know, someone may already know from reading if they've already taken it up, but I'm not sure if that's the case or not. We will not know for sure probably until around July 1st to July 4th when the budget's traditionally approved by the legislature. And I guess technically we wouldn't know until the governor completes his vetoes and the legislature completes their overrides either. What our plan is, though, is we plan to continue to gather information and we assess the likelihood of a local aid increase that would give us comfort in increasing our revenue estimates. And we're very hopeful for that. We have really put on a full court press in advocating for additional charter reimbursement. But as I know we've all experienced before, there's diverse needs in the state legislative budgeting process, and we're hoping for the best, and we're going to continue to advocate this week and through the Senate process, but we would be happy to keep you up to date on what we're hearing so that we're all on the same page about how we think this will play out.
Okay, great. Thank you. And then the other question is just on external funds and how that's reflected in some of the overview pie charts. So some of them say, for example, the capital budget overview said it was city sources only, and just wanted to get a sense of which overview slide, which of the overview slides include all of the grants that we approve and all of that.
So none of these include grants. These are all general fund.
Okay. Is there any way to get a summary of everything? Just so we have a sense of what programmatically is being supported and where.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Katie, and thank you guys for being here. I'm going to be very brief. Most of my questions will be reserved for the departments, but I just had, so I was also interested in the state aid side of things, just coming out of the State House and watching their budget process. So I think it's something that's useful, not just for the president, but also the entire council body, as we're figuring out the unknown and how realistic some of these numbers are. Mm-hmm. So that was one of my questions. It also, another question had to do with the fire and police OT, which is very exciting. So being realistic and to say maybe that this, if this does not happen, what does that mean? I understand how you got to those numbers and that they're in the police department is already working on sort of reductions, and I'll save some questions for them. But what does this mean if they can't stay within that budget?
Thank you for the question. We are obviously very optimistic and we'll continue to work with them to ensure that they do meet those targets. But if a scenario were to unfold where the overtime exceeded budgets, those are accounts that are allowed to exceed mm-hmm. budgeted amounts and run deficits, which Katie talked a little bit about. That's what's happened in the past. In order to achieve a balanced budget, we would need revenue to exceed those additional expenditures by at least that amount. So we could still end the year with a balanced budget, even if they do go through their overtime budgets, but we're committed to ensuring that that doesn't happen.
And is there a process of sort of tracking that over time, since this is something new and the council learning or having updates based on their targets and where they are, so we understand sooner than later if they're not going to hit these, stay within these budgeted amounts?
Absolutely. We get updates. The police department actually does an update on these at their CompStat meeting. And so this is something that their organization is tracking throughout the year, and that through their CompStat meeting, they're holding their managers more accountable. Mm-hmm. That's actually a clear place where we do see the hours as they go.
And we don't have a formal process in place for updating the council, but we would be happy to update you if that's something you're interested in.
Absolutely. Particularly, it's something that's innovative and creative, and I applaud you guys and the mayor for doing it. So most of my other questions were answered, but can you explain a little bit what the Parks First, what is that? What's envisioned for that?
Right.
Just generally, obviously, we'll have these further hearings related to each of these, but curious as to what that actually would entail.
So this is both capital and operating investments, really focused on trying to make sure that the parks space is the most accessible and equitable. And as there were several park projects that were quite large in nature this year that I think were quite game-changing for several parks. And I think the Harambe Park, for example, just finished, is kind of in the process of finishing that master plan. And this mm-hmm. is a phase one implementation. That's a very large park, and it requires more than just doing a playground at a small park. The investments that we have in this Parks First program are that sort of investment, are kind of larger parks that touch a lot of communities, that are focused around equity, focused around kind of what the community is saying the needs are, and are really going to be game changing for those parks. So the ones we highlighted, I think are great examples. And then on the operating side, we do have smaller investments in trying to make sure that we have a seasonal workforce that can really make sure that they're kept clean, and that we have some additional ranger staff to really focus on safety in the parks as well. So that's really what it's a comprehensive initiative. I'm sure Chris Cook will mm-hmm. go on and on and on about this if given the opportunity. So I suggest you talk with him as well.
No, absolutely. So Dave, Katie, and Sam, thank you again, and look forward to working with you all during this process.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Asabi George.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Councilor Siomo, for chairing this great meeting and chairing this process. as I explore and get acquainted with this fascinating budget process for the city. As I have a brief statement and then three questions, but I think I'll probably just ask one of them. But as chair of the new Council Committee on Homelessness, Mental Health, and Recovery, I am certainly grateful to the administration for their emphasis on ending chronic individual homelessness and providing better services to those that are battling substance abuse disorders. I really want to make sure that we're bringing these investments to the forefront of the conversation and that we're making sure that our programs are complementing the work that's happening on the state level and certainly working hand in hand with our nonprofit partners. I have a particular interest and focus in my work on family homelessness and look forward to working with the administration in that area as we move forward. Also, as vice chair of education and a former Boston Public School teacher, I'm incredibly concerned about our BPS budget and want to make sure that our dollars are reaching the classroom and reaching our kids and really impacting in a positive way the education that's happening. My, one of my guiding principles as I look at the BPS budget in particular is what we're doing impacting the learning in our children in the classroom. And that's really sort of the root and the question that I'll ask throughout the BPS process. And most particularly, looking at the services we're providing our almost 4,000 children that attend BPS that are homeless. And that's a significant number. It's almost 7% of our student population. And happy to work on that effort with you. Overall, when I look at the budget, I'm really concerned about our need to create and diversify revenue streams and recognize that we've sort of reached our cap. We have reached our cap on leaning on property tax as revenue, and what we're going to do as a city to lean on the state for additional aid. And that's really sort of where my first question or my big question for you is as that state aid declines and becomes a bigger problem for us in the city, what are our goals, what's the administration's goals to increase state house advocacy and really work to get a bigger chunk? You know, what Councilor Baker brought up and your response is we're getting, 5 to 7% of state aid.
Yeah, I completely agree and thank you for your comments. The mayor has taken a new tack with state house advocacy this year. He has, in the past, what had happened was the mayor would bring all the delegation together for one meeting, kind of go over the priorities, et cetera. He has sat down with every single member of the delegation and walked through how important increased funding of the charter school funding reimbursement is for the city of Boston and for how important that is to getting additional dollars to BPS. That has been top of every single conversation. We have joined him for every single one of those conversations, really making sure that we drive home to our delegation how important this is. It also, we're also advocating, like I said, for charter school reimbursement and that the charter school reimbursement funding is directed towards those communities like Boston more disproportionately impacted by the increasing cost of the assessment. So I would say the mayor has taken on a much stronger advocacy position as in this budget, and we're really hopeful that we see play out.
And I would add, I think we're trying to take on more of an educational role in this as well, and that I think manifests itself in what we're doing here as well. We're attempting to provide more context as to why we are where we are, why we are here today, relative to state aid. We've given presentations at the State House that allude to that. We've met with each individual state delegation member, a lot of hours put in for that. We've also met with the administration, which actually paid off in that we received about a $5 million increase to our charter reimbursement appropriation in-house too. We now just have to try to see that through the legislative process and make sure it gets back to BPS where it belongs.
It seems though, and I'm encouraged by that work, but it seems that we're planning on that to happen. And a lot of our programs are planned around whether or not that would happen. For example, extended learning time. We worked really hard as a city to have that happen. And I, as a teacher and as a parent of four BPS kids, had some reservations about ELT, extended learning time. But now that we're there, with a select group of schools participating, we've paused future schools adding on to that. And that's created some great inequity across the schools, across our schools, and for full disclosure, including my own children's school. We were slated to be part of the second group of schools to get extended learning time for next school year. That is now paused. And it seems like some of these initiatives are dependent on a change in that Chapter 70 funding model.
I think I attempted to lay this out earlier. We've attempted to balance all of the needs of every individual department, but the reality is, under our current revenue structure, we just don't have the revenue to support all of the desired programming. This is one of the ways that we're trying to improve our fiscal situation between now and July, is advocate for more revenue. And we hope we've clarified the path here so that people can see a cause and effect. If we are able to somehow come up with some more revenue, there are specific programs that we'll be able to fund, but absent that, we will have to make reductions elsewhere to fund any additional spending items that come to be between now and June. So I think we're as frustrated as you are trying to identify additional revenue sources. Our hands are largely tied, and we require state approval to do almost anything on the revenue side.
Well, I would think that, and again, I don't know this due to a lack of experience, but I think that we need to go beyond the Boston delegation. They're such a small part of of the state house.
And I totally agree, and we have met with legislative leadership as well on both sides in the House and the Senate in the attempt to do that.
Right. Thank you so much, and I am excited about the start of this process.
Great.
Thank you. Well, Councilor Jackson? No.
And I do want to thank you for correcting me on the increases over the course of time. But I just would note, and I want to read them in for the record, for the past 10 years, 4% increase in the school budget in FY07. FY08 was a 6% increase. FY09 was 2%. FY10 was 1%. FY11, it was 0. FY12, 1%. FY13, 6%. FY14, 6%. FY15, 4%. FY16, 4%. And FY17, 1%. And so what I would note, and I do take my boo-boo relative to the FY11, because we did not go up that year. But I would note that was a very different fiscal time than we are right now. I guess the couple of other areas I wanted to ask, just the police budget, there's a terminology piece here. And if you can, just for folks to, so we've budgeted the police for a specific number. Mm-hmm. And year over year, at least since I've been here, I'm sure since the chair has been here, they've blown through that number, sometimes doubling that number, right? And I want to compliment you on dealing with the reality that we normally budget it. And again, past administrations, you had to squirrel some money away someplace because you knew they were going to blow through it every single year. One, I'm happy that it actually has a budget and we don't have the doubling effect. So can we speak about, from a budget perspective, the actual increase versus what we're now, because we've looked at the appropriation in the past, but What is the actual increase budget year over year on the police relative to the overtime? And do you understand what I'm?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. It's as a result of those moving parts, it's a pretty confusing situation this year.
Yeah, give me one quick second here.
And just to add a little color commentary, the police department, because it's an emergency department, unlike other departments, we can't stop that spending. You can stop that spending, but we don't have the ability to stop that spending. Is that true?
I think that's
relatively
accurate.
And you're going to stop it.
We're trying.
That's good. Okay.
But to your question, so there's an adjustment being made from 16 to 17. So the actual increase we're budgeting from FY16 appropriation to FY17 recommended is 23.8 million increase. However, the increase over what we're projecting in FY16 is 1% or 3.9 million. So we have to I think you understand.
No, I get it. Because there's a methodology change, which is you're actually budgeting for reality, which we haven't done in the past relative to the police budget. We've held the budget at a specific number. And on top of it, one of the things that you're baking in is that they've gotten raises in that time, and we haven't adjusted during that time frame. So I just think it's really important that we actually are letting folks know what's happening there.
Agreed.
I guess this component around the charter side of things, are there any anticipated increase in transportation that we will be assessed relative to charter? I know it's about $14.5 million annually this year, and I know, and you can, if this is something to answer tomorrow.
So I think what you're saying is that BPS, as part of their budget, pays for charter transportation. It is not part of our assessment, so we don't pay it. When you look at that above foundation spending level, they take out transportation costs associated with that.
Okay.
So it is part of BPS's budget.
Yep. Okay. Oh, okay, so we pay it, but we get the money and then we pay it out. Okay.
Yeah, we pay it through BPS rather than through the assessment. Yeah.
And the changes that are happening relative to savings to transportation, what does that look like?
I actually ask that you talk to BPS tomorrow a little bit more about that.
Okay.
I think they'd be in a better place to.
Okay. And I guess a couple components that I would like some of the departments to be thinking about. So in I filed some hearing order for the level 4 bio lab. There's a change in support for biosafety and bio level 4 level 4 training. It went from $205,000 to $90,000 this year. That is a concern for me, considering that BU is going to have level four, potentially have level four capability. And the question is around that training component. And then that guardrail component, can you explain? So one of the pieces that we do know is that BPS actually made a decision to do what they're doing. And I know Sam and others were excited about that decision. And I want this, when we say a budget is a value statement, we need to note BPS made that decision to do the hiring as they do it. It costs us about $13.5 million a year to do what we're doing. And in a time when we've changed the evaluation, there are other things that could have been done to change this. I just want to put that forward. What is the guardrail component around early hiring? $13.5 million is a big ticket item. And in fact, that is the exact same amount that we're going up. So that is, again, a decision that BPS has made in the past. For the public, what this means is that when there is they have an open posting, people who are currently in the hiring pool, that in BPS that we have contractual requirements for. They actually are competing with people on the outside, kind of like musical chairs. If you don't get a chair, we actually still foot the bill there. But this was a decision, a strategic decision that BPS made, knowing that there was going to be cost and involved in it. So what does the guardrail terminology mean?
So let me actually, I was hoping while you were talking, I was going to be able to find the answer in my book because I want to be specific. Let me instead just ask BPS to respond to this question tomorrow.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I'll turn it back over to.
Sure.
Geared toward the school department, irrespective of the fact that the charter tuition assessment is going up. So the city is absorbing that, protecting the school department by providing 35% of total expenditures each year.
But we also need to note that our expenditures, our total expenditures for schools as a percentage of our aggregate expenditure is in the bottom third of the state of Massachusetts. Most people in the state of Massachusetts are spending much more as a proportion of the aggregate budget relative to Boston.
Well, so I think yes, but that's because most of these communities don't have all the services that Boston provides, which accounts for that. I mean, in a lot of the suburban communities, the school department is the biggest budget, and by far over any other departmental service.
And
so you're going to have that change, that higher percentage.
And that is true. And in those communities, when, first off, year over year, they fund their schools, and year over year, if there is a shortfall, many of those people actually go to the community, and they actually do Proposition 2.5 overrides in many of the communities that we're talking about. They also don't have the type of land value that we have. I would counter that statement there. So I guess when it comes down to it, we still, as a proportion, spend less. We're in the bottom third of the 351 communities, which I believe is the proper context based on the fact that we have a foundation budget, and I think it makes it difficult when we look at other states versus some of the comparisons that I've seen that. We do better in special ed. We do better in ELL. We do more for our early learners than other places. And you know, I get offended when we compare ourselves to Texas, because we're not Texas. We do much more for our young people, and I think we should be proud. And I think it's absolutely critical that we look at our apples to apples versus other places. And like I said, there are cities that are right next to us that spend much higher per pupil than we do, and I think we should fill the gap.
Okay, thank you. Council Baker.
Yeah. Sam, I to get back to that point that we made about what the city of Boston puts into the state coffers and what we get out of there. As a representative from the Research Bureau, you guys guide us along on how to spend our money. Do you have any lobby wing through the Municipal Research Bureau at the State House advocating for us to get more money, more of our share from the state?
Well, we have periodically and for some time talked about the high reliance on the property tax, and there ought to be more diversification of revenue. It was a report by the Research Bureau in 1986 that helped lead to the jet fuel excise and the hotel motel excise. So we have done that in the past. I mean, we are a voice that is speaking to the issue of diversifying revenue sources, and that will continue.
Up the State House?
Yeah.
Okay. That could have been a yes or a no, but.
No, but it is an issue that, with strict home rule.
Well, and that's another problem,
well,
home rule.
But that is the problem.
Yeah, we have to go to the state to get more liquor licenses to raise or lower speed limits and all this stuff, and we're not getting our share. So I would ask you as representative if maybe we could come up with some kind of a plan to lobby the State House with your help. Can we talk, and back to you guys, so I see on page 26, FY investments, and we're talking about, you know, different streets, investments in Sullivan Square and Central Square and Quincy Street. Like, who are those, like where do I find information on that? Will that be between traffic and parking and public works? Very interested in Quincy Street there.
Absolutely.
And where that whole, what the plan is going to be, how we're going to roll it out, what is it going to look like?
So we can flag this for you as a follow-up question. I would definitely say this is in transportation and public works that you can follow.
Okay, if we can get some information on that.
You said Quincy?
Quincy Street, yes. And also, very excited about upgrades to a couple of my libraries, Adam Street, and then also Upham's Corner, trying to get a new library there. And I would like to impress upon this administration, we did have hearings on it about mixed-use libraries. There's no reason why we shouldn't have senior housing above these libraries. I mean, East Boston Library is beautiful, but I think there should be 25 apartments above it. So if we can keep an eye on that, there is a plan going around for Fields Corner, mixed-use development that Viet 8 is actually floating around. I could get that in your hands, and we could look at that. And then my last question is, I see a study for a community center in the North End. How do I get a study for a new community center in Dorchester?
We can certainly talk about that.
Would that be with you, Dave?
Sure.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Anybody else? Thank you. Okay, that concludes the administration and finance overview for the fiscal year 17 budget. I want to thank everyone for their testimony and their participation, and this hearing is adjourned.
I knew I lost a couple pages.
Pop your bind
in the middle. In the middle.
Oh, yeah.
Ways and Means, and I'm also the Alston Brighton District City Councilor. Today is Monday, April 25th, and we are here to review several revolving funds, which I will read into the record. I want to introduce my good friend and colleague, soon to be married, Councilor Matt O'Malley. Congratulations. I'd also like to remind folks that this hearing is being broadcast on both Comcast Channel 8 and RCN Channel 82 and recorded for future viewing. I'd ask folks to silence any electronic devices. We will also take public testimony and would appreciate it if you would sign in and check off the box to testify at by the door. There's some sheets. We do ask that you state your name, affiliation, and residence, and limit your comments to a few minutes to ensure that all comments and concerns can be heard. We are here, as I said earlier, to review five dockets, revolving funds. Docket 0544, message in order authorizing the Mayor's Office of Arts and Culture to reestablish, in accordance with General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53E and a half, a revolving fund to accept from the fund up to a maximum of $300,000 to fund fiscal year 2017 to purchase goods and services to support public art throughout the city of Boston. Docket 0545, message and order authorizing the Mayor's Office of Arts and Culture to establish, in accordance with General Law Chapter 44, Section 53, E and a half, a revolving fund to accept from the fund up to a maximum of $150,000 to fund fiscal year 2017 to purchase goods and services to support the operation of the Strand Theater. Docket 0546, message and order authorizing the Mayor's Office of Tourism to reestablish in accordance with General Law Chapter 44, Section 53E and a half, a revolving fund to accept from the fund up to a maximum of $300,000 to fund fiscal year 2017 for the purpose of purchasing goods and services to advance tourism and promote participation in public celebrations. Docket 0547, message and order authorizing the Law Department to reestablish in accordance with General Law Chapter 44, Section 53, E and a half, a revolving fund to accept from the fund up to a maximum of $500,000 to fund fiscal year 2017 for the purpose of purchasing goods and services to pay for repairs to city property. And finally, Docket 0550, message and order authorizing the Office of Environmental and Energy Services to reestablish in accordance with General Law Chapter 44, Section 53 and a half, a revolving fund to accept from the fund up to a maximum of $100,000 to fund fiscal year 2017 to purchase offsets of greenhouse gas emissions, which shall be associated with a portion of the electricity consumed by the city annually, thereby greening a greater percentage of the city's aggregate electricity load. We have several members of the administration here to testify. I want to welcome you, thank you, and also recognize that we've just been joined by Councilor Anissa Sabi George. Just for the process of this, I ask that you introduce yourself and which fund you're representing here today for our review. And just for clarification, it looks like there's just one new revolving fund being established as part of these five that we're reviewing. Very good. So with that, I'll turn it over whoever wants to go for it.
Great. I'd like to start with the Arts and Culture Fund. So we're asking to renew the Public Art Fund. These are revenues that come to us from the Public Works Department. They're the sale of excess rights of way, proceeds mm-hmm. from that. Mm-hmm. And then they are mostly spent on conservation of artworks. We don't really have any other way to fund conservation. So we think that because the money comes from Public Works, it's sort of a great way to do that one-time kind of conservation, mm-hmm. physical, public work type improvements for public art. The other fund we're looking to establish is for the Strand. These are funds that had in previous years been in our prior incarnation merged department. So we're continuing to execute the separation of arts and culture from the tourism and entertainment department. So these are funds that sat in the Fund for Boston Neighborhoods. These are deposits and rental revenues from the operation of the Strand Theater. And then the expenditures are for ushers, box office staff, some of the part-timers that then we use to execute mm-hmm. those events. So those are the two, the two revolving funds for arts and culture.
And before I continue, could you introduce yourself?
I'm sorry, I forgot to introduce myself. Okay. Hi, I'm Julie Burrows. I'm the Chief of Arts and Culture, and I oversee the Mayor's Office of Arts and Culture.
Thank you, Julie.
Good afternoon, Councilor. My name is Joseph LaRusso. I'm with the Environment Department. I'm here to speak on behalf of docket number 0550, which is the reestablishment of the Environment Department's revolving fund. This is a revolving fund that accepts revenue from the sale of solar renewable energy credits that are produced by the city's solar arrays at 201 Rivermore Street and 400 Frontage Road. Those revenues are used in turn to purchase carbon offsets to green the city's electricity load.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Ken Brissett, Director of Tourism, Sports, and Entertainment for the City of Boston, Mayor Walsh. Here to talk about the City Hall Plaza Rent Fund. And the purpose of this fund is to purchase goods and services to advance tourism and promote participation in public celebrations from lease revenues received from the rental of City Hall Plaza.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Don King. I'm from the Law Department, here to speak about the revolving fund. Hi, I'm Don King. I'm from the Law Department. I'm here to speak about our revolving fund. Just in a nutshell, that fund is used to purchase goods and services to pay for repair or replacement of city property that was damaged by third parties.
Great. And just for, we've also been joined by Councilor Frank Baker as well. And just for my colleagues' benefit, Mr. Brissett has a conflict at 2 o'clock. So if you have any questions for him right now, it might be best for him if we could get those out of the way.
Thank you.
So with that, let me recognize my friend, Councilman O'Malley.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate this. I always look forward to this as you kick off your very thorough and exhaustive ways and means budget hearing process that we begin with renewing the revolving and operating funds that come through this. And they all obviously make sense and are terrific, and appreciate the mayor and his vision, particularly on public art and engaging more and working in the neighborhoods. Obviously, Joe, I love you, and I've spent many, many of these hearings talking about ways to increase our desire to have more PV paneling on city buildings. So just very briefly, these are the two. This is Rivermore Street, which is the city archives in West Roxbury near Millennium Park.
That is correct, Council.
And then Frontage Road, is that
That's the central maintenance facility.
Central maintenance facility. And that generates revenue just by the fact that they're both places where there's a lot of sunlight, and through the course of a year, they can...
That is correct, yes.
Do they power their facilities as well as creating this offset?
Actually, the energy that's produced at 201 Rivermore Street is actually used to credit the City Hall account.
Fantastic. Okay. Yes.
And the array at 400 Frontage Road is used to provide a portion of the load for that building. That building is so large that the array that's there is not large enough to power the entire building.
Yeah. And are there, I know we've talked about that we were able to secure some state funds for looking at some other community centers, 4 or 5 of them, I believe, in the city. Is there a plan to look at some other city buildings, like City Hall, for example? Would we be able to have photovoltaic panels on the top of this? Or does the shadow from some of the surrounding buildings make it not workable?
Yes, Councillor. The city is actually soon going to be releasing a request for proposals for a power purchase agreement that would site solar panels on 21 city buildings, up to 21 city buildings.
Fantastic.
We have not completed structural studies on those buildings yet, so that number may be reduced once the structural studies are completed, but that is the goal.
And is City Hall one of those buildings?
It is.
Good. I would think there'd be not a lot of structural problems with this massive concrete building. That's great to hear. Well, keep up the good work. I know you, and your team, and obviously the mayor, committed to this. Ken, you're doing a great job. I know we have a lot of events. Had a great time with you and the mayor on Friday as we saluted the Boston Pride Women's Professional Hockey League, World Champions.
That was pretty touching.
Yeah, that was a great event for a number of reasons. And with City Hall or with Government Center Station open, the plaza looks great, better than it has in years. And I know people often will contact my office and my colleagues will put them in touch with you looking to increase the opportunity to hold some events on the plaza. So, and Don, that's interesting that you're here. I guess that makes sense. So with your revolving fund, it would be give me an example of third party damages to city facilities.
One of the most typical damaged property is probably a transportation signal, a big belly, traffic light pole, street light, things like that, usually caused by motor vehicle accidents. So we go after usually the insurance company of the vehicle and file claims and lawsuits if necessary to recover the money.
And how much money have you would you recover in a year?
The figures I was presented with for FY15, we took in $134,747. This fiscal year, it's already gone up to $170,000, and I believe that keeps growing based on department participation.
That's great. And just so for those who are watching at home, you know, a lot of our city assets are damaged by, I would assume the majority, as you said, are motor vehicle accidents. So by allowing your team to be able to go after the insurance, we're able to go after taxpayer money, essentially. Or I'm not phrasing that, we're able to reimburse taxpayer money for for accidents that happen.
Yep.
Great. All right. This is an easy one. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Asabi George.
Thank you so much. So I have a couple of questions, and I don't know if this is the appropriate venue, but how do we determine what becomes a revolving fund or what goes into a revolving fund as opposed to back into the general fund? I don't know if that's...
I can answer that.
Thank you.
For our fund, anything on the plaza that's 3 days, 3 to 72 hours or more, that money would go into this revolving fund, which last year was $183,823. If there's anything less than that 3 days, all that money would go into the general fund. So that would be an example of for something that goes with our fund.
Okay. And then with the insurance claims for property damage, we as a city have to replace, whether it's the Big Belly or the light pole, whatever it is. Why wouldn't that money then go into the general fund or back into that department's fund if it's, you know, bus transportation, for example, or public work?
So my understanding was the purpose of this fund, as opposed to just using the general fund, which we had been using, is to more actively encourage departments to work with us to report damaged property. And then they can see kind of a dollar for dollar, one for one take in and deposit, and then be able to very quickly utilize the funds that we take in to replace, let's say, a park bench, or, you know, we've even had damaged monuments before that needed to be replaced.
But all right, thank you very much. Yep. That brings some clarity for me.
And a lot of times, especially with the law department, I think it's you have to go after insurance companies to get the money back to pay for it. And this way, we kind of can replace the equipment in a more expedited fashion.
Right. The departments don't have to wait for me to get a check, basically, as long as there's funds already in there.
Gotcha. Okay. Great.
Yeah, very and good. For the Strand Theater, it's really mostly money in and money out. So people who rent the Strand Theater, their rental revenue actually covers the cost of the part-timers to execute that event. So for us, it's just a mechanism for doing that in and out that's dedicated to the Strand Theater. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I'm all set. Thank you very much.
Great. Councilor Baker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon. Ken, can you talk a little bit about, will this revolving fund have anything to do with the new RFP for enlivening the plaza, that whole whatever it is they're going to do out there, Ferris wheel, skating, that sort of stuff? What does that look like for this?
Everything that we do now on the plaza for all the activities, Puerto Rican Festival, Pride Festival, Dominican Festival, all the festivals and everything that still happen on the plaza, those will still be happening.
Mm-hmm.
So what Delaware North will be doing is they will take stuff, any dates that remain open, that they will come and they will put some things in there, mostly, especially for the winter, for winter season. And then we'll still be going to be working over like we did last year with the side entrance.
Mm-hmm.
We're working on that as well. So we'll be, and they'll be helping us with that too.
Oh, so are they going to be set up, break down, like, so they'll have a whole, whatever it is, set up, and then they'll break it down. If Pride's coming in, they'll break their whole thing down.
Yeah.
Wow. So the receipts from last year are $183,000.
Mm-hmm.
So does that mean there's a surplus left? That's why the revolving fund is $300,000.
Yep.
And if we go over $300,000, where does that money go? Just into the general fund? Like, have we been over $300,000?
No.
Okay, so that's a big number. Where we always stay underneath it. Okay, can we talk about the Strand for a little bit? You just mentioned that that's $150,000 just kind of for operating. What is the plan with the Strand? Do we have any any long term? So like, do we ever going to rent that out for concerts or money generating? Like how are we going to really enliven that and you know, generate some money there?
Yeah, as you know, my staff operate it with, I would say, a real shoestring staff.
Yep.
And the operating kind of capital expenses are split between my department, D&D, and property and construction management. Many people have suggested that perhaps the Strand could be better operated with a different configuration. And so we are interested in exploring that with the community. We applied for a grant to have a community process to explore the burgeoning cultural uses coming to that area. So the Metropolitan Planning Council will help us with a community planning process this summer to explore what's the optimum vision for that neighborhood as really a cultural cluster. There's
yep.
a couple of new organizations moving into the area, kind of changing the energy. And so at the conclusion of that community process, we'll look and see what has the community helped us understand is the optimum vision for the Strand, and then we'll move forward from there.
So would that be, would part of that conversation be possibly a private operator taking that over and then paying rent to the city?
Yeah, that is one of the possibilities that we think could be appealing as an optimum way to operate the Strand.
And like how much deferred
yep.
sort of maintenance is
sure.
up there?
Over the past 10 or 15 years, there have been about $15 million of capital invested in the Strand.
Mm-hmm.
This summer, we've got some more capital happening. We've got an elevator being put in, and we're doing some sprinkling. So we're doing some basic life safety and maintenance. But as to the remaining deferred, we try to keep up. And there's always the cosmetic things, which
yep.
we haven't really done. So I would say in the several millions of dollars.
Yeah. And that's probably more of a property management question anyway. Will you talk a little bit about, I have 2 o'clock also, that's why it's kind of like speed dating here today. I'm trying to get all my questions in.
Sure.
Can you talk a little bit about the Brown Fund and what your office's role in the Brown Fund is? Because we had a hearing here last week and it seems to be run by the Treasury
yes.
Department and
uh-huh.
in like, how much involvement does your office play?
Yeah, we sit on the review committee. My public art staff is here. Karen Goodfellow is the director of the Boston Art Commission. And we have a role in reviewing the applications that come in. And then we certainly work with every single one of the selected projects. We work with them on project development, some very hands-on, some have more capacity and we don't work as closely hands-on, but we always are trying to work with them so that they can successfully come to the Art Commission if it's on public land
mm-hmm.
And get through that process. So it really differs project by project, but we don't administer that funding and we don't administer sort of the call for projects.
So like as far as the follow-up, a project got approved, they're 1 year into it, it may take 18 months to build out. Does your office ever go back in and see where the project is? Because I think the Treasury Department has a property manager down there mm-hmm. that kind of checks in on the process. Are you guys involved throughout the whole process?
You know, it really depends on the project itself. Again, if it's on public land, we will be involved. We do like to see that there's progress being made, and sometimes it takes a long time for the proponents to gather the funding, to have their community process. So we do try to stay involved on an as-needed basis.
Okay. And Dawn, how are you today?
Hi.
So $500,000 that's just in there, so that's so we can pay and then chase the money through the insurance companies.
Yeah, it works both ways.
Yeah, so if the insurance company is quicker to pay, then we can just use insurance money, but that $500,000 is there for just so the broken street light isn't hanging around for 6 months waiting for the insurance company.
Right, yeah, it's capped, I believe, at the $500, and I think currently we're pretty close to that at this point, so it depends, you know, what the departments want to use the money for.
Yeah, so, and that $500 is basically from insurance claims. That from property that was damaged?
Yes, all the money that's in that fund comes from recoveries from damaged property.
Okay. And Ken, last question, where does the money get spent? The 183, like, what do we spend that on? It just repairs for the plaza and in any other incidentals, or can you kind of break that down on how that money gets spent?
Yeah, I'll give you an example. When we had the World Cup soccer for that TV,
yeah,
we use it for that. When Paris had the incident in Paris, when they came over here, any events that we have, Caliente, Donna Summer Disco,
right,
all those
okay.
events, one Boston Day, the buttons.
We use that revolving fund to pay.
Anything that happens, it's the money is really used for anything that happens on City Hall Plaza.
That are our events, city events.
Right. That okay. will engage people to come down and enjoy it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Campbell.
Hi, and thank you for being here. I apologize for missing the beginning part. I think I'm pretty much caught up. First of all, I'm excited to see the Strand Theater Revolving Fund. As someone who represents mainly Dorchester, Mattapan, and folks are looking for more art opportunities and art on the general level of using art as economic development, using theater and other things as economic development. So I really appreciated Councilor Baker's questions. Just sort of one follow-up question related to that. So there's some planning or community process being done. Is this by MAPC?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
So this is the first I've heard of that, and yeah. I know them well. How do they plan on engaging community and, yep. and possibly is there an opportunity for the city council and yeah. the city to work with them?
Absolutely. We only were just notified that we were successful in this application, and we have not yet started working. So we'll be sure to keep you informed on the timeline and everyone who needs it. We would love to help us identify who are all the organizations in town who need to be involved, and we'll come up with a timeline. So we're just getting started on that.
Well, that's very exciting because here we have a historical site that can be used for so many different purposes, yep. For so many different neighborhoods. So that's very exciting. So please feel free to connect with my office as that gets developed. The last question I had, or maybe it's a couple, has to do with the plaza and looking at that as a rental space. Can you talk a little bit about what events were supported? I mean, you talked about the events a little bit earlier with Councilor Baker. What events were supported last year? And there's one question in here about neighborhood-based events, specifically any neighborhood-based events that came down here used the plaza.
Yeah. Dominican Festival, Puerto Rican Festival comes down. Boston Pride Festival, Gay Pride in June is down here. We really took a lot of the festivals that were over at Franklin Park, and we brought them all down here. It's for the most of them have parades, and the route that we use is Boylston Street down to City Hall, and then it ends up at City Hall Plaza. So it works really well. It's for safety. It's really good. Now that government center's open, it's easier to get to for everybody. We use it for our Dorothy Curran music festivals, which is basically the festivals for the elderly. We have a new venue but we're having a gospel fest this year. We have the circuses out there right now. We have we're going to do a country music festival in September. We have Caliente, which is always good. We have who's coming back? Tavares is coming back. And then all the flag raisings that we have within the community. I mean, we could get you a schedule of everything that happens on the plaza. And if you go on to the cityofboston.gov's website and you go on to visitors and tours and sports entertainment, every single thing that happens in the city that comes through my office is on that list. So you'll be able to go in there and see everything that's happening. And we can give you a list if you'd like.
No, this was great in terms of just an overview.
Yeah.
Because off the top of my head, I know of many festivals that in here that come down here or do things on other days but connected to a parade or a festival. My last question has to do with those who rent the plaza for their various events pay a rental fee.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any exceptions made for nonprofit organizations
yes.
or smaller groups of folks who come together for across neighborhoods to do something special but can't maybe afford the fee that the city charges?
Yep.
We actually do. We waive the fee on I have several organizations that actually, most of the ones I just mentioned, we waive the fee for.
And how, what's the criteria in deciding to waive?
It would be a city-sponsored event through the mayor. So the biggest rental fees we get would be Boston Calling. Again, it's going to be three days or more. So we don't really have a lot of those events.
Mm-hmm.
Boston Calling, the circus, which is out there right now. There's also, those are the two biggest ones that we get. And then there's Best of Boston, which will come in and they have it for 3 days. And those are the ones that we get. But all the Dominican Festival, the Puerto Rican Festival, we waive the fee for those social groups.
Okay, no, this is very helpful. Thank you so
You're
much.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Great. I think that's it for, I just had a question regarding the Strand being the new revolving fund. In order for you to start using that fund, I think, do we have to probably vote on it? So we should talk about that maybe offline. And my only questions would be, who do you anticipate to rent it? What are the fees do you think you're going to be able to get? Are there going to be nonprofit discounts?
We're not going to change our current rental structure. It's actually a bargain, and we waive it as much as we possibly can. There's hard costs for cleaning and sometimes extra personnel that is just impossible for us to waive. But when we find a partner who we want to work with, like the Mass Leap and the Youth Poetry Louder Than a Bomb Finals, which is going to be at the Strand on May 7th, you know, we'll partner with them. And if we have it in our budget, we'll share the costs or cover some of those costs because we really want them to get in the door as cheaply as possible. Mm-hmm. So we really won't be changing any of our fees. I think, you know, it's maybe about $1,300 to get in and cover all the costs. So it really is very cheap if you talk about 1,400 seats.
Right.
We do also have a box office and a ticketing service that we can offer users. So the full rental schedule is on the website. And so we've been using a different fund to deposit all of those revenues. So now we'll have our own fund and we can better sort of track and manage those funds.
Where is that money now?
Yeah, the money is currently, because the Mayor's Office of Arts and Culture used to be situated within tourism and entertainment, it's actually at the Fund for Boston Neighborhoods.
Okay.
So as soon as the fund is approved, we'll start to then use the new revolving fund, almost like our new account. And then we'll slowly phase out the use of the Fund for Boston Neighborhoods and exclusively use the revolving fund for the Strand Theater.
Right. Do you happen to know what the balance is right now?
Oh, do we know what the balance is? We can get that figure to you.
Yeah,
we'll get you that number.
And when you say expenses such as ushers, are those for each different event, is it different staffing? How does that work?
Yeah, we have a regular core of part-timers who we work with when we need them. It really differs with the show and what kind of crowd it might be.
Mm-hmm.
So some shows need more technical and lighting and sort of stagehand type people. Some have a very minimal setup, so they'll use fewer people. Some make use of our box office. Our ticketing and box office, so we might need a little more front of house.
Right.
Some of our renters actually have their own ticketing, so we don't need that. So it's custodial, security, ushers, technical staff, front of house, all of the sort of bread and butter operating that we sort of grow when we have a bigger show, and it might be very, very lean when we don't have something happening.
Well, that's great that the Strand is going to be utilized, hopefully even more than it is now. And with that, anyone else? We're good. Thank you. Well, thanks again for coming down, and we'll probably see you around City Hall at one event or another. So this hearing is adjourned.